Alrighty. For the last 2 months, I've been working over at Curtin ICRA, developing a radio meteor observatory. I've had a lot of progress, and I've found a frequency to monitor, and I've set up a relatively autonomous meteor detection and counting system. Towards the end of this week, I'm hoping to set that up at the Perth Observatory, where it's going to have access to the internet and share its information with a sort of a global network of people. Just to get started, I'd like to review the basic ideas involved with observing meteors by radio. Up on the screen, you can see a diagram of the geometry involved with reflecting signals. The forward scatter principle is a fairly straightforward one. It involves separating your transmitter and receiver in space, and the transmitter will beam a signal skyward. And for it to bounce back to the receiver, you need to have a group of points in space along an ellipse. The requirement is that that ellipse needs to fall between two height bands given by the sort of ionization requirements in the atmosphere. So where that ellipse falls between about 130 and 80 kilometers, you'll be able to have a sort of a patch of sky that's illuminated by your transmitter, and from there you'll be able to receive signals. So those are the basic criteria for reflection. The signals that we're interested in, the parameters of the signals are things like the mass, the velocity, the height of the signal, the echo power. Unfortunately, for a simple station such as the one I've set up, the only real parameters that we can measure are the duration of the signal and counts per unit time. At the start of my project, I was basically given a box of equipment and said, here you are, go do it. So on the left-hand side, you can see very faintly my dipole antenna strapped to the pergola outside Curtin. From there, the antenna cable runs through a small hole in the window. There's only two rooms in the building that can take the cable in through the window. From there, it runs into an amplifier through the communications receiver and onto a standard desktop computer running a sound card with a freely available spectrum analyzing software. You've probably already read the questions, but these questions are the ones that I asked myself at the start of the project, and it was in being able to answer these questions I found myself making progress. The ones that were the hardest to answer were what settings do I need to have on my receiver and on Spectrum Lab to make sure that I'm seeing meteors, and once that was sorted out, how do I discriminate between genuine signals and spurious signals? Once I'd understood the equipment well enough to get started, my next main task was to search through the frequency band for a usable frequency. I had two methods for this. The first was a rather blunt approach of setting my receiver to be driven from a Perl script that Megan donated to the cause, and it would cycle through the range of frequencies from around 40 megahertz all the way up to 150 megahertz. I was looking for a usable frequency to monitor. But a quick calculation, if I was looking at each frequency for about 15 minutes and stepping through the frequencies in 3 kilohertz steps, it'd take me over a year to get through that whole frequency band. So the second more refined method was to look through the list of radio licenses that the Australian Communications Authority has on their website. And by refining the requirements that I had for a transmitter, I was able to fine-tune the search down to a very few number of TV stations that would have been appropriate. Once I'd found that station, the next main task was to script a counting function using Spectrum Lab, which has a sort of a conditional actions, and every 200 milliseconds it would evaluate the if statement, and if it was true, it would then do some statement that I gave it. Once I got that working, the next thing I wanted to grapple with was understanding why it was that I was seeing signals and being able to explain the data and making sure that it wasn't just spurious signals that I was observing. The basic counting function would take the audio signal from the sound card and using the conditional actions that I described in Spectrum Lab, it would reduce that to a text file, and from that text file I can create Excel spreadsheets and graphs of the variations in time of meteor signals, and I can also produce what's known as a colorgram image. The problem with the counting process is that there are a lot of signals that look just like genuine meteor signals, and because I was scripting the counting function myself in Spectrum Lab, it's quite difficult to script it in a way that excludes the spurious signals but includes all the meteor signals that you want. On the top left, you can see what I think is a a sort of a sudden, it was called sporadic E, where the E layer of the ionosphere all of a sudden just bursts out with sort of a highly ionized region. And for that reason, you're seeing reflections of the signal down to your receiver. The interesting features of that signal are that there's a constant carrier wave on the left hand, on the right hand side at 1,000 hertz. So there's that sort of constant strong line, but then there's also this vertical sort of extent to that signal. And it's that vertical extent that that I try to count meteors with. So you can see that that's obviously going to be quite problematic. Here's another sort of indication of the same thing, where the doesn't have quite the same sort of outburst, but it does have the vertical extent along the carrier line. This image here is from another TV station that I was monitoring for some month, for some time. It's a signal from about 2,000 kilometres away in Adelaide. You can see that the carrier signal from that station kind of drifts around in time, but it's basically a faint, persistent signal. And I think that that's from very faint high meteors. And because the mass of dust in the upper atmosphere, there is sort of a constant influx of very faint meteors. That means that I can see that signal. Just here on the bottom left, the map shows the positions in the world where similar stations have been set up. All these stations contribute data in the format on the top left to what's known as the Radio Meteor Observatory's Bulletin. And it's sort of a global network of amateurs and interested observers that share their data. So on the top left is one of the first plots that I've made. I haven't yet contributed that to the system. And on the right hand side is a blow up of that coloured image on the left hand side. What this shows is a 1 hour section for each day across the whole month, and the colour indicates the level of activity. It's interesting to note that the two images on the right hand side compare activity both of observers in the UK, so in a similar geographic position, and I'm pretty sure they're observing the same frequency, but their different methods mean that they count meteors in a very different way. You'll notice that the top scale, which is David Entwistle,